piano drop. Piano drop.
Seen the video linked above, I basically fired myself from my own vlog as the composer and asked you to rescore it. And what we just looked at there was a selection of how differently people approach the same brief. Really fascinating to see the wonderful work that you put into it, and I thank you for that. I was also involving a group of about a dozen students from Edinburgh College, and as I warned you, I'm about to pull the rug from underneath you. But before we go and see the students and do this heinous act, I really enjoyed this sequence. Tin snips.
Yeah, that sounds good.
And I think we're going to need some safety goggles as well. Just thinking more. And I have the sense I can do something with this too. We definitely need some goggles.
Can we get a bag as well, please?
So all we need now is a place to record it. Stuart, it's lovely to see you again. How are you doing?
I'm very well.
We're keeping appropriate. Thanks, Native VS. One of the more humorous approaches to that home base sequence that I really enjoyed. Right, last week we discussed the five cardinal rules of composition, media composition. We're about to find out that there's a sixth. Well, thank you all so much for your submissions. I really appreciate the work that you've put in. What I'm hoping to do with Alan here is to provide you with a real world experience without being horrible and without being trying to put you off, but just to give you a sense of what happens to your music and what is often asked of you, and also maybe the odd curveball that's thrown, and there will be today. But there's just a couple of really important things that I'd just like to show you. The first is naming. I think what's really important to imagine is that you are working probably directly with a director. You're working for the producer, and you will probably have a lot to do with the editor. And it's really important to make friends with the editor. If you get the editor on side, they'll help you stay on the show. But you are part of a larger crew, namely there's a big sound department that has three departments within it: music, dialogue, and sound, you know, sound design and all of that kind of stuff. And as a consequence, you have to be mindful and have empathy for your crewmates. So attention to detail is not only something that proves a degree of professionality to other members of the crew, the editors, the assistant editors who will be handling your material, but also if you don't have an attention to detail where delivering this stuff is concerned, it will cost your crew time. They will be confused, they might get stressful, and so we should try and avoid that at all costs. So the first thing I just wanted to say is naming. I think it's really important to try and establish a consistency for naming. We know that this project is called Eddie Cole 2021. I think it's always really handy to put the date in, but most importantly, in situations like this, which is ostensibly kind of like a pitch scenario, always put your name, because things get separated. The other stuff, you know, that's really good about putting your name in every single audio file you put out there is I know that editors, audio files will sit on their systems for years. And I've got gigs where an editor has stumbled across something, listened to it, oh, that'll fit that section, thrown it in, director's gone, I want that guy. And he's looked, he's gone, oh, it's a composer. I remember Christian, he did something with Richard Hammond. So just, you know, brand and stamp everything that you produce. So that was my first observation. My second is that
Some of you appeared not to observe the BITSY, or burnt-in time code, if you recall, on screen. So you successfully synchronised the picture to your music and were able to send me back a successfully synchronised film. However, your timestamp is not correct, and I'm going to show you why this is important. So what I'm going to do is going to pretend to be a dubbing engineer, and this is what they will 100% or 99% of the time be working in Pro Tools, for those of you who don't use Pro Tools. Now, you see here, I've got not all of your files. There was a couple of files which were sent which weren't WAVs, so I couldn't work with those. So that's another thing to be mindful of. I'm going to slip these in here. There we go. And now I'm going to spot them. These are actually BWAVs. Most DAWs export as BWAVs, which stands for broadcast. And broadcast WAVs have a timestamp in. So if I click on spot here and hit spot here, you'll see that there's an original timestamp there. So what I'll do is go up there. Now this, again, don't know who it is, whole WAV without dialogue. But you'll see this all looks really smart, because basically it lines up with the beginning of the film as a file. The sync plop lines up, but also that's all been spotted automatically. Now let's go to the file named the GIMP. Click on that. You'll see that the timestamp is different. Now, it's not a problem if the timestamp is different and you're not kind of starting from the beginning. You might start from the first cue. That's not a problem. But the problem here, if I hit OK, go to the original timestamp, is it just doesn't go in the timeline at all. In fact, it's 9 hours late, or 9 hours early, rather. So that is problematic. And if we just go back here again, so basically what your dubbing engineer then has to do is a bit of detective work. So actually, let me just spot that in to the beginning of the movie. And let's see, 09, 59, 52, 00. Okay, let's go back to that. And you'll see this does, it doesn't have the sync plop, but it does appear to line up with where our music cues start. That's okay. It's not too much of a stress to try and figure out. But I would personally recommend that whilst it doesn't matter what hour you're in your DAW, it is really important to understand that your files are going to be going all over the place and they need to be synchronous. And this is one of those cardinal rules, I think I said to you, of deliberate legal broadcast quality. It needs to be synchronous. Robbie, you see, this is a good example of an original timestamp that's not the same, but is synchronous. You can see that the music starts the same as the other submissions. But Robbie, what I would have preferred would be if it had the sync plop in, but also if it just started at the beginning of the file. That is just, it's like triple jeopardy of this is definitely in. You will often receive quite panicked messages from dubs. At any time of day, you won't be able to predict when they get to your music of, is the sync to this correct? And often what will happen is you'll find that the dubbing engineer will start to lose faith in you. So maybe you haven't hit all the cuts and purposely you've agreed with the director that it's going to be smooth and not be cutty. But because they haven't got these reassurances of the timestamp, the sync plop and the beginning of the file, there's reason to maybe question your music, even if it is in fact, as Robbie's is here, synchronous. Just a general note from the demos that I heard is they sounded very dry, and I just want to make you aware of what happens to reverb when you've got dialogue, room tone, other sound effects going on. Basically, the majority of reverb is in the sibilance, and obviously sibilance is what we tune into to really understand words. And what you'll find will happen when you put your music behind dialogue, sound effects, traffic noise, is the reverb will literally disappear. So whilst I'm not encouraging you to overuse splosh, as I call it, reverb, I think you'll probably find there will be a preference from your dubbing engineer for you to be wetter than you would be if it was for the radio or for a track for an album. So that's just that's a very generalized note. The other thing I would say is, you know, I think a real attention to sound is an important part of media composition. It's not just the composition, as I said. In fact, it's not about the composition at all most of the time. So an attention to the quality of sound is really important. And that, I mean, there were some great sounds in there, and there were some sounds that I thought, well, I think there's some better sounds out there that you don't have to pay for. So I'm not plugging. Well, I kind of am, but... if you haven't downloaded all of the labs, I'd highly recommend it because they're of a very high quality. You don't need contact to use them. Right, so let's move on to this next lesson. If you recall, I split my personality into two people, a director and me just kind of helping out as a fellow muso. So we got a letter from the director, and it says the subject is your music... some thoughts. Very kind of ambiguous. So let's see what the director says. Hi there. Thanks for all your wonderful music. I have to say I found it so inspiring that I've had a bit of a tinker with the film. So good news is loving what you submitted, but he's had a bit of a tinker with the film. And I think what we have now is much better. So could you have another look at it to make sure everything fits? I can assure you, as we know about synchronicity, if they've moved one frame, we know none of it'll fit. So we've got another pass to do. Sorry about the extra work, but as I said, you inspired me, so it's kind of your fault. This is a classic narcissistic move of projecting out basically a change of mind from the director onto a composer who's now going to have to do some extra work unpaid. Whilst you're having a look at this, again, may I make a few general suggestions? So this is very typical director speak in the sense of, I've changed my mind about the direction of this film. I love what they've done, but I want them to do a bit more work. And I'm going to kind of just say, oh, you know, make it seem as if it's kind of optional. Of course it isn't. The narrative has shifted slightly, but in a way that will make your life easier. For me, it is about two opposing factions. The bad boys doing this awful thing to a piano, so threat, and a graceful old piano that we should feel an affection for as if it was our own family heirloom. I think if we play the menace super menacing, we'll extract humour and ridiculous of the piece better without trying to be funny. Conversely, I found a piece of music for the end that I think perfectly conveys the spirit of the piano. Honourable, sophisticated, and a slight aching sense of impending loss, the end of the road. In general, everything I heard was fine, but I don't get true epic from the stuff submitted. It needs to be bigger and louder. Whilst I was pleased not to hear old-fashioned sampled orchestras, it in general tended to feel very digital and not organic. How about some low orchestral stuff? So this is classic director doing a vault face. So he's kind of led you down a garden path. He's not accepting blame for it. And he's now suggesting something that he didn't want in the first place. I am trying to be a bit of an asshole just to give you a sense of how directors work and what you'll be up against. So how about some low orchestral stuff that's super fat and distorted? He probably doesn't know what distorted means. So whenever he ventures into things like the words modulation, I think they kind of understand what organic or analog would mean, but things like modulation... there was a director I worked with who said it's too reverby and ended up with a bone dry score because every time I played anything, it was there's too much reverb, too much reverb, too much reverb. We finally got to the dubbing stage, everything mixed, everything bone dry, not an ounce of reverb on it. And she said, I still hear loads of reverb. And so we isolated all of the stems. And she said, there, that reverb there. And it was actually a modulated tremolando guitar, which we removed, but she was still left with a string score that was bone dry. So here's where I think we should take this in this final pass. Oh, and by the way, the temp is now a motorway pile-up, so let's look forward to that. We've got all of these cues. To save time today, what I've done is I've actually duplicated sheets. So that was last week, this is this week, and we'll just go through and re-spot it. But I think we should maybe just watch it together and see how much of a car crash this is. So we've got our film, open the movie, extract the audio track. If you recall, this is just reference audio, fully mixed. This is great for you if you want to just look at it on another machine or whatever. So let's, as before, I think the beginning is 59.52.00. We've actually got three files this week. So we've got temp, which I imagine is going to be useful for us because it'll imply everything we need to replace. Dialogue, And then diegetic and sound effects. Does anyone know what diegetic means?
If it's happening on screen and you can hear it as well, or if there's a source happening,
absolutely.
Like character actually can hear it.
Spot on. So that'll be like when I play the piano, and also you'll see some other stuff which you can probably see on the screen already. Create new tracks, and what I'm just going to do is plonk that in. I had a go at the edit earlier for not putting a sync plop on every one of those. But you see, this is all, you know, just we have to do what the edit gives us and the edit has to take what we give them. Of all of the cinematic tropes, the one that has really stood the test of time is that of a piano being dropped from a great height onto something or someone.
Oops.
It is sustained through the silent era, through the heyday of the Muppets. Hip. It's all the way to YouTube.
Wow! On!
And why is this? Is it the knowing familiarity of these objects, that they tend to be expensive, family heirlooms, really heavy, and not the kind of thing you should hoist into the air? Or is it because we all have a perception of what it would sound like once they come crashing back to Earth? Thing is, I have my suspicions about whether a piano would actually sound like that if you were to hoist it and drop it. So I thought I'd find out by taking a piano, hoisting it into the air, 100 feet into the air, and by letting it fall back to Earth. I've recently learned how pianos actually work, and they're a weird Frankenstein-type object. It's actually a dulcimer with this keyboard mechanism attached, loaded into what is ostensibly a wardrobe. So the dulcimer is basically this solid cast iron frame, the thing that holds the strings at huge tensions. The average piano has just under 20 tons of tension in the strings. That's 20 giraffes. The thing is, the strings are actually very thin. They don't have a huge amount of surface area to move the air about with. So they're connected via this bridge here to the soundboard. This is the most important acoustic element of the piano. It's a huge sheet of wood, which you can see under the strings here, which is also held quite taut in a dome shape called a crown. So my fear is, by disrupting these key features, the strings being held at great tension, being attached to a bridge, being attached to a soundboard, and the soundboard being intact, the piano's not gonna behave like a piano anymore. And what could cause this disruption? Well, I think dropping it from 100 foot probably would.
Time to meet the GIMP. A vintage Broadwood made especially for John Cuthbertson and Sons in Glasgow in 1900 and frozen to death. This beast has had the shit played out of it, has really seen better days, and was about to be thrown onto a tip. We felt it only appropriate to rescue it and see this piano off with more of a dignified bang. And when I say it's had the shit played out of it, the elephant is falling off it. It's been played so hard, very much on its last legs. So in order to usher the very best, its inner beauty out, we thought we'd go and get some tools.
Tin snips.
Yeah, that sounds good.
And I think we're going to need some safety goggles as well. Just thinking more. And I have the sense I can do something with this too. We definitely need some goggles.
Can we get a bag as well, please?
So all we need now is a place to record it. So here's the GIMP preserved for future generations. Has a mellow, endearing quality.
But we also saw this as an opportunity to carry out some experiments, doing things that you wouldn't nor shouldn't do with a piano.
Including giving it a good flanneling. beautiful.
These instruments you can download for free from pianobook.co.uk, by the way. Just search for the GIMP.
And then we started to get a little bit more aggressive, including rudely inserting nails in between the strings.
Finally, it came to this.
So after a day of cruel torture, we decided to put the GIMP out of its misery, hoist it up 100 feet in the air, and find out for once and for all, what does a piano actually sound like when it falls back to earth? I think what's interesting about viewing the footage is the piano appears to explode on impact, as if those 20 giraffes worth of pent-up energy are finally released. The resonance in the strings, the soundboard destroyed in an instant, making the sound of the piano landing not what we expected, but more of a...
But I guess, like many cinematic tropes, there's a bit of artistic license. When you punch someone in the face, it doesn't sound like this. Candles aren't loud. And nightclubs aren't quiet.
Where you been? You're supposed to be here at midnight.
Girl, you can't rush perfection.
And pianos, well, when you drop them, they just splat. But it's with the magic of cinema that we can bring forth a more dignified and sonorous end to the GIMP. Right. So, how do you feel? Not in the stomach? Or I suffer from firehead, which is forehead is kind of flaming with rage. It doesn't get any easier the more experience you get. I guess you just learn how to deal with it and you understand that it's just a natural thing that we suffer from, and it's ego, and egos are useful and helpful, and it'll drain away. And you just need to assist that drainage process. All is not lost. You've already had a go at this film. It'll be easier second time round. But the job that needs to be done is a respot for this recut for your revisions. So in the video description down below is the second downloadable pack of assets for you to work with. Let's go back to the students and start respotting this.
There's a saying in Hollywood at the moment is just wait for the first recut. And this is in reference to when Hollywood gives big film scores to artists. Now, if you recall, the five cardinal rules I gave you was be able to write to picture, write to brief, write fast, deliver legal broadcast quality materials, deliver it on time, on budget. Where artists are concerned, write to picture, well, you know, you'll often find that big artists will write a suite of music and then music editors will fit it. Write to brief, often you want to use, I don't know, Vangelis, you'll get Vangelis. Write fast, Vangelis doesn't write fast. Deliver legal broadcast quality is probably the only real cardinal rule that they'll stick to. And deliver it on time and on budget, well, I think you know the answer to that. However, there is a sixth cardinal rule, and that is to be able to take notes and revise your work. And this is something that a lot of artists really struggle with. So when the big kind of composing houses and big composers lose, say, a massive franchise, like, I don't know, Superman, to some kind of Danish neoclassical kazoo playing artist, they always say to each other, don't burn your bridges with the production, play nice, just wait for the first recut. Because this is one of the most common things. This stuff happens all the time. Now, I would admit this is an extreme version in the sense that it's ostensibly a different film. And there's a reason now we can see why the wording of the email was weird. And that is basically he's shunning his responsibility here for getting you to basically do your job twice. And this is to try and stop you from maybe speaking to your agent. This is what we refer to in advertising as a rebrief, which should trigger a second fee. What I'm really excited about is that this now is, I think, a very, very watchable film. And I think this is going to get, I hope, 100 plus thousand views. Spitfire loves the film. So this is going to be absolutely front and centre for Spitfire's Piano Day campaign. So a lot of eyeballs are going to go on this. And as a consequence, it's going to be professionally colour graded and professionally dubbed as well. So it's going to look the business. And I hope you agree that it's more of a consumable, well-contained film. How many of you spotted what the end music was?
Thomas Newman from American Beauty.
Absolutely. And it's a bit of an in-joke because basically every single film and TV programme that media composers were writing on in the noughties had American Beauty on. And it's very interesting putting it against that picture because it has this solemn sense of nobleness. The original scene that it's from is actually of a crisp packet flying around in the wind, and the music gives it this sense of profundity. For me, I just think this is a great validation of what we do. What is fascinating is that this sequence, when it falls back to Earth, is absolutely frame identical to this sequence. I don't know about you, but I actually find that quite moving, how powerful that is. The entire meaning of the sequence has changed, but it also feels like an entirely different edit. You notice the slow motion more. You don't notice the cuts as much. And I think that, for me, fills me with profound excitement for what we can do to movies. And I think this is something that you should be, well, I would be excited about, is the fact that they're giving you these sequences with absolutely nothing going on. They've taken all the presence out, and it's just all about showcasing what it is you do. Okay, so I think what we should do, if you're okay with this, is to respot with some notes. And I have some thoughts about how we can make this a really, really strong score. Personally, this idea of the baddies, the guys who are executing the piano, and the piano being the kind of protagonist, I think is very helpful. Because ostensibly, I think what it means to me is there are two main themes to write, and there's possibly just another section that we can talk about. So I think we need to, instead of think of it as a 7 minutes to conquer, it's two pieces of music that we need to write. The Thomas Newman piece illustrates the power of something that's really been thought out. It's really interesting for me to return to that piece. It sounds like a drone and a piano and that's it. But the orchestration is a lot denser than that. And what I take from it is an intentionality in the simplicity. And I think that whilst it is not expected of us to write excellent music, to do broadcast quality, so it should sound good and be synchronous, all of that kind of stuff, and that we have to do it to brief and take notes and revise and all of that. But we have this secret weapon, and that is the power of composition. And by nailing a really good tune, you'll be awarded all sorts of concessions. So we've really got nothing going on until here.
And why is this? Is it that knowing...
I love this theme and the way it bubbles underneath. Can we not finish it before the piano scrunches, but just tacit it when they hit and then feed the cue back up again and again hard out for the shot of the upright on the farm? Okay. Sounds quite cryptic, but it isn't. Let's just mute all this stuff out. Let's just mark the in point. It's kind of a loose in. Again, got my Bitsy up here to be able to do this. Hint, hint. 34, 12. Let's just do this so we can actually see what I'm doing. Okay. It's a lovely piece. I haven't a clue who wrote it because it wasn't labelled. Now, director wants us just to keep going. And then literally these sounds will just break your cue. So just pull the music up whilst he's doing this. And then feed it back up. Okay, so that's actually on the, again, classic. Yeah, so that's actually on the top. So basically, we will start the next cue there and end the previous cue as well. And that is when, I don't know if you recall last week, I spoke of checkerboarding and the need to having two tracks overlap your master session that you build the cues up in. Okay, 01. 10, 13. And then we can conveniently copy that for the next one. It seems to be really working, that track. There's a minimalism. It sits under the dialogue well. It's bubbling away. There's emotion to it. Motion as in motion forward, you know, there's a kineticism to it. But also there's an emotional affection, which I think is really good. So temp works well. Just remember to keep going. Except under piano schmush is. Next up, upright and into drop. Currently, so introducing the drop idea. Currently, these are different bits of cues. I love the hit on the piano, but we should keep the menace under the presenter, but smack back in on every return to the farm. Off for the piano drop so we can hear the scream. So let's just have a look at that and see if we need to interpret what he said. I think that he's inviting you to really hit those cuts. And I think that you could hear that we ducked the music underneath me speaking. But I think you should be able to do it with your composition. So I'm just going to mute the music. So bang! 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 If you know what I mean. It doesn't always have to hit the one of the bar. It doesn't always have to hit a crotchet beat. You can do it on 16th pushes and all of that kind of stuff. So just find the general tempo. See if you can get maybe two or three of those cuts to kind of hit beats that are very obvious, and then hit the other ones just with, you know, off beats. Especially, I guess, with the stuff that's bubbling underneath, you can stick a 5/4 bar in there if you need to, just so that you're maybe coming in on the one, you know, when we go back to the crane. And I think that these things, stuff that ramp into cuts, they hide a multitude of sins. So if you are having to add a little 2/4 bar here and then there in order to really hit, smack on a bar, if you hit a riser going into it, can be just a reverse cymbal, something like that, you'll find that'll really smudge over the non-musical aspects of what we're doing with media composition here. So keep bubbling. Try to make work as a composition. And when in doubt, use reverse risers, cymbals, etc. And should try and hit all cuts somehow. We've got an overlap here, so again, important to have your checkerboard. DocuBed. I didn't think I was going to use these, but you inspired me to try. Whilst I like this one, I fear the piano top line may pull us out of what the presenter is saying a bit. Make sure everything is in the same sound world, so don't totally change tack so it feels like a collage of different music. Could be like Q1, but slightly more bubbly, maybe. So let's have a look at this. I mean, the ideas that come out of that immediately is maybe try not to be melodic when you're sitting under factual dialogue in particular. Factual dialogue tends to be non-stop. It doesn't take pauses. Drama, you can kind of, you can find your way around almost like a jazz pianist would. But factual just tends to be a continuous stream of dialogue. So be careful about pulling people's focus with melodies. And I think when he's talking about a collage, it's just basically, it shouldn't feel like a bit of music that you've whacked, kind of tacked in. It should feel like, I think the whole point of writing to picture is to create a thematic arc, one score that sounds like it's from the same world, same sounds, that kind of stuff. But maybe you could add a rhythmic element or something. So by collage director means make sure it relates to your other work on this score. Okay, so this is, what is this? What is a piano? So let's have a listen with the dialogue.
Frankenstein type object. It's actually a dulcimer with this keyboard mechanism attached, loaded into what is ostensibly a wardrobe. So the dulcimer is basically this solid cast iron frame, the thing that holds the strings and...
So I think it's that top piano that is just poking out a bit. And that's probably why they're holding the bed quite low.
Area to move the air about with. So they're connected via this bridge here to the soundboard. This is the most important acoustic element of the piano. It's a huge sheet of wood, which you can see under the strings here, which is also held quite taut in a dome shape called a crown. So my fear is by...
Okay, so this is, I think, a different subject matter. He goes, and this is, again, really important to listen to the dialogue and what's being said here. I'm going to demonstrate what I mean. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to add a pitch plugin in. It's always at the top of my recent. And my preferred modulation is a minor third. So if we just have a little listen, I think this is a great way of kind of motivating change. So it's like I've done an exposition on what a piano is, so now I'm going to form an opinion from that.
Surface. So they're connected via this bridge here to the soundboard. This is the most important acoustic element of the piano. It's a huge sheet of wood, which you can see under the strings here, which is also held quite taut in a dome shape called a crown. So my fear is by disrupting these key features, the strings being held at great tension.
So I'm going to make just an internal note that you can avoid if you want, but I think modulating it there, maybe not as ridiculously badly as I've done there, but... at 10:02, new paragraph, maybe modulate and increase intensity, that word that people use, which doesn't really mean anything. And we're going up to here. It really is back-to-back cues at this part of the film. 10, great. And let's copy it. It's pretty much, let's have a look.
100 foot probably would.
Time to meet the GIMP. So just let's just mark it here. We can always have an upbeat going into the cue, but 10:02, 40:09. Meet the GIMP, love this piece. This is close to our theme. That's a good sign from that director, but it gets busy, not hooky enough. The beginning is my fave bit, repeat, develop that. And again, with factual entertainment and with drama, don't be fearful of being simple and repetitive. And again, spend time on those first four bars so that you can repeat them and perform them very slightly differently and shape them to the picture. You're in service of telling the story. You don't have to go off on a you know, wonderful musical adventure. A vintage broadcast especially for John Cuthbertson and Sons in Glasgow in 1900 and frozen to death. This beast has had the shit played out of it, has really seen better days, and was about to be thrown onto a tip. We felt it only appropriate to rescue it and see this piano off with more...
It just, again, pulls focus away what's being said, which is quite important at that point, you know, what's being... It's been rescued and stuff.
More of a dignified bang.
And when I say... We need to kind of be more it's out there. The I like it. Can peter out, maybe? 05, 02. Groovy. So, meet the GIMP. So, I see that we only have three cues left. And we'll do questions in a minute. We'll see. Enjoyed this. Now, this is when, you know, we've got baddies before. You know, in that opening sequence, what is it? 1M... 02, introducing the drop idea. Now, I would say, again, it's a non-linear process, that this is your kind of real master cue. And then what I would do is I would go back from this point and possibly compose the intro to the drop idea from this cue. Or indeed, go to this cue that's coming up and then just... go back through the cues throughout the piece and just generally kind of chill them out a little bit more, just so that you get an idea of theme development. Like the intro, isn't quite mean enough, could be bigger. And don't stop, just settle to a simmer and go even bigger on the studio front door shot. Also go back to simmer under starting to play piano samples. So, not giving a sense of when we should come out, so let's determine that. So,
tools.
Snips. Yeah, that sounds good.
Keep going.
And I think we're
going to
need
going.
Some safety goggles as well.
If it's just marking time, just keep going. Don't get in the way of the dialogue, but just keep it so we feel that the music hasn't just died away.
Can we get a bag as well, please?
So all we need now
bubbling
is a
away.
Place to record it.
Boom. Keep going. I think what we just need to do is just, we need to come to a finish on the fade. So, a little bit of a fade. Let me just make this bigger. So we need to kind of cadence to this point and just have a natural kind of die away there. So I'll just make a couple of notes there. Okay, so what are we looking at? So we're talking about keep cue going throughout and naturally on fade. Fade to black. So that's home base. Awesome. So actually three cues to go. Brilliant. So nothing. This is all just me playing annoying noises. And then...
No, actually sound like when it falls back to earth.
So this, I think, is as big as it should get. This should be your biggest point. It's, you should be cranking out sausage meat. It should be really loud. And again, they've... not bothered with any sound effects. You're not get. You've just got free reign. This is very, very rare. You'd usually have clang, all of that kind of stuff. So this is a really nice situation. First kill, I'm going to call this. Death sequence. Bigger! They always say that. Like beat, but we're not hitting cuts enough. Also, can I have a definite out on the drop? So let's have a look at that. So let's
actually sound like when it falls back to earth.
I would personally congratulate the preamble. So I'm going to mark that as that's definitely where the cue should start. I think that works really well. 16. Preamble. Great. Then smack in. Try to hit more cuts.
When it falls back to earth.
Here's an example of you're really hitting the one and you're anticipating the cut. So what I would do is I would still play that chord there, but I would then put the accent so it would be like dum dum kush like that, even though it's not
on the one. So, dum, boom, ga, like that. So it can still be one, but you can, it's just showbiz, jazz hands. So that's an interesting one, because that's on the offbeat. Dun, 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 boom. That's great, so that's a great hit there. I think that we need to kind of be out bang on that shot. I think that's going to be the easiest way of getting out for the scream. So 10, 05, 37, out on ground up crane shot. And then there's just a bit of kind of remorseful music here. After the splat, like this quirky refrain, theoretically, it could almost be a foreshadowing of the final cue coming up. So that's something to consider. I think what's interesting about viewing the footage is the piano appears to... There's something a little bit pathetic, is not the right word. It's just a bit kind of pitiful about. It's like I pity the piano, which I think is quite sweet. 05, 45, 12. On impact, as if those 20 giraffes worth of pent-up energy are finally released. The resonance in the strings, the soundboard destroyed in an instant, making the sound of the piano landing not what we expected, but more of a... But I guess, like many cinematic tropes, there's a bit of artistic license when you punch someone in the face. I really like the where that ends, so I'm going to mark that. I think this works because it's pitiful, not sad. The in and out points work well. 10, 06, 11, 08, after the first kill. Now, it's interesting, the last piece was really slathered on, and it's interesting because the director does have lots of notes. Second kill, let's hope the final. Okay, so, cinematic death. This is nearly perfect. If anything, we could hit the cuts more, but I wouldn't want any more than this, both notes and numbers of instruments. I think what you're playing here is the contrast between evil boys killing a piano and let's think about the piano and all of that stuff. But I wouldn't want any more than this, notes and numbers of instruments. So the cue should just lift. And I think that's a great kind of non-muso comment, numbers of instruments, because they'd probably be surprised at how many are in there. So the cue should just lift for the release of the piano, maybe with some hint of the piano strings rotating. Don't know what that means. The way I would approach that is some maybe kind of cymbal brush, or even if you had access to a piano, just literally stroking the strings. I would like the sustaining element to carry on through the drop and the smash, the piano smash. As it's tonal, I think you should do this and make it so it somehow fits the key of your piece. So basically what we're referring to, I think, are these rather ridiculous sound effects that we put on here. So I think you should make it so it somehow fits the key of your piece. The effects I have in at the moment are comedic. With some of the piano drops in the cartoons that's earlier on the piece, they had more of a pitch centre and were very heavy sounding. Maybe they pitched the piano down. So I guess that's, you could say, it's like you imagine that the strings have lost tension, but not totally lost tension. So you could try pitching that down. It needs to feel fucking massive, Hollywood with a naive sound of piano strings with an insane thud or taikos or everything. So I think you just go for, just think, how would a piano sound being dropped if it was in an end game? I think the theme or the piano part of the music should return on the close-up of the smash in 07 minutes 14, just like the temp does. Other than that, love this cue. Oh, also, the beginning has to sync with my hands. Let's just turn off the dialogue here. I think that I enjoyed the kind of drone coming in early, giving a sense of portent and emotional compass to the magic of cinema. And I think the intro, good. Think magic, of cinema. It's very soon after that cut that the piano is actually dropping. I would suggest possibly the last bit of your music or modulation, if you will, transient. So if it's a piano play, I think should be on that frame, personally. I don't mean to prescribe, but that's what I would suggest. Come out on cut to crane overhead drone shot. Remember to keep sustaining all the way until 0714. So that's the moment where, so just imagine it sustaining, so we can almost like just fudge it. So if we go that, so. Let's see what we mean by. Purely for illustration. Nice little moment at the end there with the strings coming up. You may want to observe. That's basically the spotting notes for the new cut. On that American Beauty, I would really try and find a harmonic language of your own. It's so easy to spot when someone's copied American Beauty, and it is a fashion that is a decade and a half old and out of date. So I think what I would request from you is that possibly that instrumentation, it relates to the fact there's a piano. So a piano and very light orchestration underneath is what I would recommend. There's an old saying that if you were to be invited to the greatest feast of your lifetime, but on the condition that one of the courses was going to be a live frog, I think it's best to just get the frog out of the way and eat it. It's a French saying that's a bit ridiculous. And by that, you've got two tough sequences in this. You've got the first kill and the second kill. And again, as I mentioned before, I think that these can be your pieces of music, the themes that you then take and borrow and pillage and place earlier in the timeline. That's what I would recommend. The burden of the amount you have to write, can it in itself put you off from writing? And a lot of that can be exacerbated by, well, I've got this easy docu bed, I can whiz that out, but I've got that bloody sequence where I've got to hit all those cuts and stuff. So I think it's better just to get those out of the way, personally, as my would be my recommendation. So there we go. Right, so alongside the downloadable pack linked in the video description down below is a link to this new spotting sheet. And remember, it's all about following the brief. And by that, I don't mean just the brief of the vibe of the music and what the narrative is trying to say. I mean, if they say hit this spot, hit this spot. I would love to see your work again. So if you do upload it to YouTube, do use the handle hashtag EddieCole2021. But hang on just one sec, because one of these students' scores is going to go on the final premiere, which will be live on this site on Piano Day on Monday from 1700 BST. Thereafter, if you come back to this video description, there'll be a third downloadable pack, which will be a fully graded picture without Bitsy and with an empty space in which you can insert your own
credit card so they can use it on showreels or indeed just upload it for YouTube for your peers and potential employers to take a look at. I hope that is impetus enough to have another go at this. Okay, so how do the students feel about it?
Did we feel a sense of remorse and grief when we saw that our music had been hacked to pieces and the film had entirely changed? A little bit. Any questions?
Oh, yeah, Christian.
My forehead.
Just go back right to the really beginning and just like a technical one. You know, when you stem the final music stem, I just recorded it. I just bust it to another audio thing and recorded it again. But it's how would you make sure that's synchronized when you pull it into like Pro Tools?
Basically, I just do something called bounce. But provided your time code is correct and synchronous with the Bitsy, it'll record it with stamp it. So okay. whether you bounce it or record via another stem, it will always burn in a time code. So I suspect those of you who sent me stuff with 0 hours stuff synchronized the film and did it all fine, but didn't make your time code, this thing here, match this thing here. So remember, we always check at the top. So that looks the same. And that looks the same. And the reason why this could differ is because you're maybe working at the wrong sample rate, you're working at the wrong frame rate. So often you might see, for example, again, I'll just whiz out like this. You may see, for example, 24 up there and 0 there, which actually means that the picture is at 24 frames a second, not 25. So that's why you've got this kind of triple check thing. But whatever you record, provided you're offset, it'll record with that timestamp in.
Hi there. So should we approach this as like a completely new composition, or are we able to use parts from our composition we sent previously? Or
absolutely. I mean, as you can hear, that I've used some of your work here, yeah. some people's work. This is where being the self-editor is really important, and this is one of the hardest skills. It's you have to ask yourself, does your music actually fit the brief if the brief has changed slightly? And there are some tracks that the director has said here that he thinks works in that position. And there's a docubed that he made that wasn't in that position because that bit of the film didn't exist. And this again is really, really common. I would just say, judge it for yourself based on the general notes the director has given. Again, I'll give you that email and the spotting notes that we've made. I think that just an important thing is, like, you know, I think always a touch of mastering at the end of the process is good to do. And again, just like with reverbs, dialogues will remove tons of top end. So you might want to be a bit more generous with your top and stuff like that. And again, you know, if you're doing that docubed, sit it under so you can actually hear every single word that's coming out of my mouth clearly, maybe without looking at the picture. The problem is, and I'm sure you've all experienced it with lead vocals, is if you know what they're singing, you can hear what they're singing. And that's why it's very difficult to be objective. But listen to the sound quality when you duck it back to the level it's likely to be played at. And a lot of you, I think, will find that it'll sound like it's gone like that. So you might want to account for that.
So I guess, like, when you like sort of playing piano organically, do you like change tempos quite a lot?
It depends on the piece. If it's a bit of rhythmic programmed loopy stuff, then you find a tempo. For something like the end, the second kill, I would prefer to do that free. I think that's something that I don't want to get too passionate about these things, but I think a forgotten form of expression is meter and tempo. And you will find the works of Dario Marianelli, there's a reason why his stuff is so expressive. Atonement, his Oscar-winning score, is actually recorded by a chamber orchestra, but a lot of people think that it really reaches into your heart. And it's not just because he's employing dynamics, great use of melody and orchestration. He writes totally free. All of his scores he writes totally free. And then he re-clicks them. I'm not saying you have to do that. If you're marking time with a piano, you can feel yourself where things are changing. But he would you know, after playing in something free that he really loves and hits all the cuts, maybe moving the odd thing so it's bang on, he then clicks it so everything else can get quantized against it. So I would absolutely encourage it, yes.
I suppose, does the same go for dynamics as well? Like in, well, with orchestral music, that there's a lot more dynamics than mixing like rock or pop or hip hop and stuff. So like, would you not use like things like compression on your orchestral pieces so much or anything like that, and leave it quite like explosive when it needs to be?
It's why orchestral music has sustained itself through cinematic music, even though orchestral music went out, a bit out of fashion in the 1980s. It's because it can be instantaneously dynamic in a way that would be really quite alarming with a breakbeat track, you know, which tends to, it ebbs and flows and you get breakdowns and stuff, but it's not, you know, you know, which is, sorry, I've probably blown your ears off, which is what orchestral music can do. I know for a fact that I would respond better to this film than the last film. There's a point to it. There's some stuff that I enjoyed researching. I didn't know that there was 20 giraffes worth of tension in piano strings. And I think that, you know, even if it's just that one thing people take away from a YouTube video, I think that then it serves a purpose other than just being an idiot with a crane in Aberdeenshire. It was so funny that the whole community came out to watch it. Something that I'm a really great believer in is, I think the doing takes up the most of our time, but I don't think the kind of concept of how I approach things ever comes at the computer. I would recommend, you know, possibly if you want to have another look at it today, but maybe using the weekend to think about it, but to not work on it. And very few directors ask you to do that, but I'm actually working with a director who asked me to do that time and time again. He goes, right, I want you to take a week off now and just think about it. And I think that you'll start solving the puzzles in your head before this bloody machine going bip, bop, bop, bop starts shoveling you into a corner.
In a few of the notes that the directors put that you've just gone over, it says he loves this bit of music, he loves that cue, for example. Our task then is not to necessarily copy those bits of music that the director loved, no, and to make something similar, almost.
Well, just listen to what it's doing.
Right. Okay.
It's in a, what's good about that good, that bubbly is an insult for the composition, because I think it's a beautiful composition. The first bubbly piano that we hear, well, why is that working? Well, it's sitting in a register that's under the dialogue. It's not dynamic, so it's not distracting, and it has a sense of, not sentimental, it just has a heart to it. There's something honest, simplistic. So you may want to do that on a guitar. I mean, obviously this is a piano piece, this is about pianos. So that's what I would take from it. A tip that I have for temp, and I hate it when people ask me to copy temp, and I'm really not asking you to copy temp here. It's about finding your own compositional voice, observing the stuff that's kind of in there. Using pianos is what you should be doing on this piece personally anyway. But other than that, it's not like, okay, that's got a hi-hat, got to copy that. And believe you me, you will be asked to copy temp, but this is not what I'm asking you to do here. So on approaching temp, the other thing is, remember cardinal rule number 4, deliver legal broadcast quality. Legal. We are legally responsible for not copying stuff. And the producers will put a clause in which will mean they're totally exempt from any action that's brought against the score. But you do get situations where an injunction is put on a film. And in fact, the first film I did for Working Title, they burnt the negative they had to burn the negative because the lawyers instructed them to do. And this was like, I think this was like a £40 million movie. They had to burn the negative because it had copyrighted material in it that they couldn't get off the screen. It wasn't musical copyright, it was artistic copyright. So it's a very serious thing. So that's the horrible thing. And, you know, I don't know, a game that I play with colleagues is going, spot the temp. you know, you kind of go, I know what track that is that they've copied there or they've emulated. So, sorry, the trick that I have is when I go and starting a cue and it says, I really like this temp, is I listen to it once and once only. And then I don't try and like, okay, and what did he do there? So even if you just make notes, piano in this kind of register, playing roughly at this tempo, these kind of notes, feels this, that and the other, and then wallop, just get rid of it.
So is it perhaps then a mixture between the director likes the piece of music as a composition, but he also loves the way that it creates an effect on screen?
Yes, that's all there. Sometimes you'll get a real muso head who'll just put a bit of Mogwai in and they love that piece. They always put Mogwai in. They love that piece. But the word you'll hear more often is this temp really works for me. Mm-hmm. And that's implying that it's working for the picture. And let's just remember that our job is to help tell the story.
So, since the temp is it's so diverse, like the instruments and sounds that have been used, then when you say like piano and light orchestration underneath, do you refer to orchestration as in like an orchestra or whatever sounds we decide under the piano to be?
Yes, like, that. Yeah, this is it's a really good point, Paola, and orchestration is usually my reference to how you voice things, what instruments you use, whether that be an orchestra or a guitar. As I always recommend with any work that you're working on, is to create a virtual band. So I'm going to have some guitars, a drum kit, an orchestra and a piano as an example. And then I'm going to make these instruments and these articulations work for the whole of the piece. What will come out of that is that you will have a cohesive, sonically cohesive score that is much more concerned with a compositional arc as opposed to a series of vignettes that work for each individual scene. So we work in cues, it's got to work for that scene, and then you need to take a step back. And if it feels like a bit of a hodgepodge, a bit of a grab bag of different sounds and styles, keys even, I would fix that. And, you know, the harmonic, you know, talking about that's going up a minor third at that point because it feels like that's a paragraph change or a shift, you know, always be conscious of the arc harmonically as well from a modulation point of view. And the very, very simple thing to do is just to watch it as a whole. But it's impossible to do if you've been spending all day on it. So for me, it's like, go to bed, at the appropriate time. Don't just go to bed in the middle of the day. Just go to bed, and then when you wake up, just watch the whole thing as a whole. And it doesn't, you know, I'm not theoretically trained. You'll just go, it just feels really samey, or just it feels like it's jumping all over the place.
If you used some of our music in the temp, like say a director recut it and used some of your music in the temp, and said, like this piece, and then all the other notes to all the other pieces, would you keep the pieces that you did for the temp and just sort of develop it? Or would you sort of do it again new?
If they say, like this temp, and it's your temp, provided you have rights to it, so it's not something that you've done for Poirot and you're putting it on Miss Marple, then absolutely. They'll probably shout at you if you don't. I said, I like this. So use that. And I got the director I spoke of that put all of the wrong music over the wrong characters, said, I can't understand why you haven't done what's on the temp, because it's all your music anyway. And it's like, because it's for the wrong character. And they were like, I don't care. And it's like, oh, well, okay then. So I think that what you will find with these situations, and this is quite an extreme one, it's a different film pretty much, but it does happen. But what you will find with these situations, with these recuts, is you would have scored the entire thing. So imagine you're on a kind of a seven reel feature. You've scored the entire thing. It's taken you 6 weeks, and they'll recut it, and you'll go, oh right, okay, that's fine. I mean, I actually quite enjoy recuts now because, as I say, they're like puzzles, and it's altering your music so it still sounds like music. So you're not putting loads of 5/4 bars and all of that kind of stuff. But what tends to happen is this big cue that you had nailed for the previous cut will suddenly have disappeared, and they've whacked a bit of temp in. And it's like, no, we want to go in this direction now.
Thanks again, Christian.
It's It's been an absolute pleasure. I've really enjoyed this and really look forward to seeing your work.
Take care, Christian. Bye-bye. See you soon.
So as I said before, there's a second download pack available now in the video description down below, alongside a link to the new cue sheet. And after this piano day, Monday, there'll be a third download pack, which will be a self-assembly, pre-dubbed version of the film, fully colour graded, with a blank space for you to insert your own credit in. So best of luck with it. Thanks, as always, for it. These have been really long, very involved seminars. So I really appreciate you watching to the end. And there's going to be lots more coming up. So do subscribe if you haven't done already, and ding that bell to be notified the next time I put a video up. One of those would signify to me that you'd like to do more of this stuff. I've really enjoyed it, and I've really enjoyed watching your submissions, and I really look forward to hearing how you've approached the final article. So happy composing. See you next time.